All right. We are back. We had some technical difficulties, but we're getting started. We're talking about mind battles in marriage. Friday night live, every Friday at 8 p.m. unless otherwise advised. Every Friday, we're having a conversation and we're bringing tools and resources to you to help you to elevate your life, to elevate your marriage, to elevate your relationship. So tonight we're talking with Dr. Cerrissa Hugie, and we're covering the warning signs of anxiety and depression. And she was talking about depression. S is for sleep, the lack of sleep or sleeping too much. I is for interest, when you lose interest in things and people and you're just not yourself. G is for guilt, feeling that internal guilt about who you are. And the C is for concentration. I don't think I missed anything. You can let me know, Cerrissa.
Sure. E for energy.
Energy.
Yeah, so
I've got that one.
Energy or feeling restless. Then C for concentration. So we talked about that depressive fog. Did you hear me when I was talking about that? The depressive fog that people complain about?
Yeah.
Because I'm not sure.
I got that.
We got, okay.
Yep.
So C for concentration. So A for appetite, either eating too little or eating too much. So people who are emotional eaters, just eating a lot, you know, kind of drowning their sorrows in food. Or sometimes people experience a loss of appetite, where they don't want to eat at all and they lose a lot of weight. So it could be one or the other. And then the P is for psychomotor agitation or retardation. So I'll explain what that is. It just means retardation is you're moving slow. So you can sometimes tell when people are depressed because they might hang their head low. They might be moving really slow. They might be talking really slow as well. And then the agitation is the restlessness that I talked about earlier, just having a lot of nervous energy, not really being able to keep still, but just feeling very restless. And then lastly, which is unfortunate, the last S is for suicide. You know, folks often start to, again, as we talked about earlier, questioning their people start to have thoughts that they would be better off dead, that they would be better off not here.
Cerrissa, you said, yeah, psychomotor skills?
Agitation or retardation.
Psychomotor agitation. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. For the P, and then the S, okay, being the
suicide. Okay.
Which certainly we hate for anybody to get to that point, but it does happen. You know, where people start to question their life. So before we talk about anxiety, what would you like to say about those symptoms, or you know, kind of add in?
Absolutely. So I think it's interesting that a lot of the symptoms is like a twofold. Either you get too much sleep or you're not sleeping enough. Either you're eating too much or you're eating too little. And what I do know is that that's sometimes hard to notice. Unless you're around somebody 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and really grew up with them and know their rhythm, right? Know their vibration. It's really hard to notice. You know, we experienced with my nephew just a couple of weeks ago who took his life. We had no idea. Vibrant, happy, healthy from what we could see. You know, the dealing with the normal day-to-day life, yes, but other than that, we had no idea. And it's hard to be able to tell when somebody is struggling, when somebody is dealing with it. I met somebody today, Cerrissa, that is chronically depressed. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure she's on medication, but you can't, you know, look on the outside. It's not something you can pinpoint and you can look out. So for us, you know, for family members and for spouses, how can we, you know, when those symptoms are not there, when those symptoms are not there, how do we gauge and how do we make sure we're connecting with our spouses and that we're in tune? What do we do as wives and what do husbands do as husbands to see if we can pinpoint some of those areas or just check in with one another often? Because when you do ask people, they'll say, I'm okay. I'm fine.
Yeah. This is true.
Don't be able to say, well, I'm struggling, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's so important, I think, for us to create spaces where people feel comfortable and feel like they can be vulnerable. It's hard to do that. But creating spaces. So for me personally, I try to model vulnerability. I try to model saying, I'm not okay. I'm having a hard time today. And so that creates spaces for people to feel like they can share. But if, you know, so often because we have social media and we have these things where we can create images and these illusions, like we have it all together and everything is perfect and we got this going on and we got that going on, when the reality is we may be struggling and there may be times nobody has a good day every single day. But with social media, we have the ability to create that. And I think so often when people say that they aren't having a good day or they're not okay, we're so quick to, you know, beat them up with scripture and say, well, you know, you can't be depressed because you're a Christian. And how can you, you know what I'm saying? Like we have
these, Jesus wasn't depressed.
Right, right. But Jesus had very hard times.
He had his moments.
Come on.
He had his moments.
You know, come on now. Yeah, Jeremiah was depressed. You know, he was the weeping
prophet. Come on,
prophet.
David.
Right.
Come on, somebody.
So we just need to understand, I think, in terms of the body of Christ. And I don't know that this answers your question. I don't really have a solution. But I think as the body of Christ and even as African-American families, you know, we need to start listening to our children because now we, before it used to be like, whatever your mama says or whatever this person says, that's what you do. No talk back, no nothing. And so people buried a lot of things and they kept a lot of things inside. And previous generations have been able to survive that, but this generation is not equipped to handle that kind of stress. And so if they're not used to talking about these things, you start at an early age, you know, from yay high, you know, getting them used to expressing their feeling words, you know, things. Look, one of my nieces and nephews the other day said, I'm frustrated. Or she said, you know, she was mad. She was like, I'm mad. I need to count to 10. And she's 2 years old. So she already knows when she's upset that she needs to take a moment. You know, she may not quite fully conceptualize that. But that's because her parents are using those kinds of words with her and asking, you know, how are you feeling? Or, you know, or putting words on their feelings and their emotions. Because some people as adults can't even identify, you know, certain emotions or frustrations. Sometimes we don't even recognize it until it's too late. And so if we get people proactive and paying attention, as much as you brush your teeth, if you feel a pain in your stomach, your mental health is just as important. So if you are proactively paying attention every single day, all the time, then it doesn't have to get so far gone. You can take the necessary steps to repair and grow and heal because you're paying attention to that. And you know, understanding when you have an injury, you might just need to take some time, you know, just like a physical injury.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what I'm hearing, you know, that model vulnerability, that's very, very, very important because, you know, we want to be strong. You know, we come from the era or you know, our history per se, mm-hmm. with oppression and depression and stress and all of these things. And we've been put down so long and we've been pushed in a corner for so long. We've been victimized so long. So we feel as if we cannot experience a human emotion, because that's what it is, a mm-hmm. human emotion, and feel like I'm frustrated, I'm overwhelmed, I'm not okay. And it's okay not to be okay, but it's not okay to stay there. And that's why help is available to all of us. So it's okay for you to have a bad day. It's okay for you and your husband to have a debacle, or, you know, you're not on 10 right now. That's okay. That's human. And the more vulnerable, like she said, the more vulnerable we are, the more open and honest we are, and the more we check in with one another and not feeling as if, okay, me, myself, and I. No, it's not about you, yourself, and I. It's about you. It's about you. It's about you. So even I feel like having that accountability, having that opportunity where you can check in and you can take your mask off. And I heard somebody say, also take your cape off. You know, sometimes, was that you, Cerrissa? I don't know if that was somebody else.
We talk about
but
the cape,
that was you. Okay, take your cape off. We don't have to be superwoman all the time. You know, we don't have to be strong all the time. I know many of us grew up independent and taking care of ourselves. And I know me, for instance, Cerrissa, you know, when I got married to my husband, I already had a life. I already had money, cars, house. I already had all of that stuff. So I felt like I was already did the dang thing, right? I was already stable, and I was already in a place where I didn't necessarily need a man for that. I didn't need a man to take care of me, but I certainly needed and desired one for other areas, you know, that I needed him for. So even with me talking to him and sharing with him how I feel, even him looking after my mental health, seeing when I'm frazzled or I'm not all put together, and when I'm doing too much, and you know, when I'm stressed out and things of that nature, I have somebody looking out for me. So I'm also saying, you know, have someone that's looking out for you, be it your spouse, be it your children, you know, and just be open and vulnerable, and don't think about somebody is judging me. You know, when you start feeling feelings of shame and feelings of guilt, that's of the enemy. That's not of God. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to mitigate. You have to say, okay, if I'm feeling this way, there's a reason why, but this is not a place that I want to stay. And you have to not worry about people judging you and looking down on you, because at the end of the day, it's your mental health that's at stake.
Absolutely.
It's your life that's at stake. It's your future that's at stake. It's your sanity that's at stake. And that's very, very, very important. If we want to, you know, grow and evolve and do all that God has called us to be, we have to be in a good place. And sometimes that takes taking a step back. I know me personally, I take mental health days all the time. I call in and I say I'm taking a mental health day often. As often as I need to. It's not that my job is stressful. It's not that I don't want to be there, but I want to take care of me. Sometimes I have to pull back from everything that's going on and just take care of me and check in with myself. Make sure that I'm doing okay from the inside out, because I can show you whatever I want to show you from the outside in. But right. You win from the inside out. Absolutely. That's what I want to say about that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, yeah. So just, you know, like I said earlier, just modeling that, and even for your children, because we're so often not used to, we won't show our children any weakness whatsoever. They can't see nothing, but they need to see how to overcome struggle. I had a, I was at an event, and a young lady said she never saw her parents argue nothing in front of her. She said her parents didn't discuss anything. And so what ended up happening was when she got into a relationship, she's an adult, she said she didn't know what to do because she had never been walked through that process, or she had never seen at least even healthy conflict, or, you know, talking through things. She never saw any of that. They kind of kept it with that very traditional parenting style where you keep every single thing from the child. And so she, as an adult, she really struggled to kind of find her ground. She said she was thankful to be protected, but at the same time, it wasn't healthy for her because she needed to have some tools and resources. So, you know, we can instill those things in our children for sure. But yeah, you're right. Looking out for one another. There's somebody that notices. Trust me. Mm-hmm. You know, we notice when things are going on with people. We may not be able to put our finger on it, but we can notice things.
Especially,
with teenagers. You know, when they start isolating and they spending too much time in their room, they're not engaging the family. I mean, just a number of things. You know, you notice. You know, especially if you're a believer, you have the spirit of discernment. You have this Holy Spirit living on the inside of you. So sometimes you can look at people and know that something's not going on. Now, whether you choose to ask them about
right,
it,
that's
or you
story.
Choose to, yeah, or you choose to, and you know, because the children these days are, you know, a lot of times they don't want confrontation. They don't want nobody to say anything to them, you know, about anything. So sometimes as parents, it can be difficult to engage those children, especially if they're defiant, because that can be a symptom of depression. You know, when they start kind of hanging out with the wrong crowd, again, that isolation, but anger, irritability oftentimes can be a symptom of depression in children and young people. It can come across as them being rebellious when really they're struggling internally.
With some other things. Wow, this is good stuff. You guys enjoying this? This is good stuff. I know we're supposed to go over anxiety, but Cerrissa, I'm wondering because we're 4 minutes out, we should just go ahead and wrap up here. I think we're going to wrap up here, you guys.
Sure.
And next week we'll talk about the anxiety and just kind of pull it all together, because this was a lot. And I believe that there are some people that really need to start evaluating those things and seeing if this is showing up in your life. So she said, S is for sleep. I is for interest, losing interest. G is for guilt. The E is for energy. The C is for concentration. The A is for agitation. The P is for psychomotor. Oh, appetite. A is for appetite. The P is for psychomotor. I wrote it down.
That's
agitation for retardation. So when you're moping and just kind of zombie, like a zombie is, right?
Moving very
like
slow,
a zombie state. And then S, unfortunately, is for suicide. So we don't want anyone to get to that point. Because there is help available to you. There are people out here. There are resources out here. It's not anybody's fault. So don't look at trying to blame anybody. Don't even look at trying to blame yourself, because that is also a trick of the enemy to try to make you feel like something is wrong with you. I'm here to assure you there is nothing wrong with you in that regard. Yeah, you may have some things going on as far as mentally, but that doesn't mean that you are a mistake. That doesn't mean that you are no good. That doesn't mean that you're a failure. That doesn't mean that you can't win, because you can still do all of those things. So for anybody that may have these type of symptoms, Cerrissa, what would be the one thing you would tell them, or how would they seek help? I guess I should say you could just give them a referral, or how they can seek out someone to talk to so they can get the help that they need.
Absolutely, sir. There's lots and lots of resources available. There's several counseling practices that I have in the Charleston area. It depends on where people are. You can certainly mm-hmm. reach out to me and I can give you some of those referrals. I'm happy to see people in my clinic if you're interested in medication, but we also have a therapist in my clinic, so I can provide that information for you offline. But the one thing I will say is there should be at least one person in your life, like Cheryl was talking about earlier, accountability. There has to be somebody that will get down with you, you know, in the pit and help to pull you up out of the pit. And for me in the pit, in past times, that's been my husband, where he's been giving me the push to keep going and to keep doing what I needed to do in the seasons where I was having a difficult time, but also being compassionate and empathetic. Because so often we can tell people why they shouldn't feel the way they should feel. You shouldn't be this, you shouldn't be that. So find that one person that you can trust and that you can speak with, you know, and be open and honest with. And I mean, it makes a world of difference because it validates you. And then we need to start validating people. You know, we need to start, before we give them solution, we need to start trying to understand where they are.
That's good. That's real good. And, you know, mm-hmm. maybe you're on here on tonight and, you know, this may be your story and you've been feeling these feelings and it has affected your marriage, because what I do know mm-hmm. is that when you're not at your best, and if you're not at 100% or even at 80%, not only is it affecting your life, but it's going to affect those around you. So maybe maybe the friction that has been happening and the frustration and the overwhelm, maybe it's because something else is going on. I'm not saying that that is the case. I'm saying maybe something mm-hmm. else is going on. And maybe you need to look further into your overall being, your mental, your emotional, and your spiritual state to see where you are and to make sure that this, you know, whatever's going on with you is not the reason for the continued distance or this unification in the marriage covenant. So that's all I'm saying. You know, we have to make sure that we are well, totally, not just in one mm-hmm. area, but totally well, and be okay with seeking the help. Like Dr. Cerrissa said, you can reach out to her. You can find her here at Cerrissa Hugie. That's Hugie. Also, her website is Mindspace. It's MYND space. Again, that's Mindspace, MYND space. So reach out to her, connect with mm-hmm. her, get the help you need, because as I always say, the better you are, the better your marriage is going to be.
Absolutely.
That's just factual. So listen, it's been a great, thank you so much, friend. I love you so much. I appreciate you so much.
You too,
just for taking your time, just for having this conversation, a much needed conversation. We're here to help you. And, you know, part of you being a wife who wins is making sure that you're winning mentally. It's making sure that you're winning emotionally. This is just not about you being on some platform and being so super spiritual, but this is again about you being well, totally and completely well. So that's our goal for you. And I pray that this has blessed you. And we'll be back on next Friday, just wrapping it all up. So meet us here next Friday at 8 p.m.
Yes, y'all have a good night. I hope to hear
from some of you. All right, have a good night.
Love you, sis. Good night.
Love you too, sweetheart. All right, bye. Bye-bye.